So yesterday we talked about the representation of matrix in terms of operators and some example how to find out the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. That also we have done. So before going to the next section, I just want to quickly tell about the projection operator. So you all know about the projection operators. Suppose you have phi 1, phi 2, etc. are orthonormal basis. So the phi 1, phi 1 is a projection operator. So in general, anything I, so this will be a projection operator, right? So this is a projection operator. What do you mean by that? If you act this on any vector, so any vector if you take and if you act on the vector psi, so this will be equal to phi I bra phi I psi, right? So this will be some number. This is basically the component of that vector along the vector psi along phi I and into that vector. So this is basically the projection vector along ket phi I. What is P I into P I? What is this equal to? What will you get if I do P I into P I? Basically, conceptually you look at that. I am taking a projection along some vector, some unit or normalized vector. Then I again take after that vector, I again do the same thing. What I am expecting without doing a mathematical calculation? This should be equal to what? It should be equal to PI, right? So once you have a vector, now you projected along this direction. After that, anything you do with that projection along this direction is not going to change. So PI square is equal to PI. What will be PI PJ if I is not equal to J? So how will you get this mathematically? PI PI is equal to PI. So you take this ket phi I bra phi I. So that is first PI. Okay, so I am trying to find out PI PI. Okay, this is what I am trying to find out. So first one I written. Second one I should use some other thing, phi j, because I should use a different index. So ket phi j, bra phi j. So what is bra phi I, ket phi j? It will be delta I j. So if it is delta I j, so what will you get? Because when I is equal to j only, this will exist. But you know that, there is no summation here, okay? So there is no sum. So if there is no index summation convention here, okay, that is very important. There is no summation convention here. There is no sum over I, because this is any individual I for a given I. For a given I. Suppose there is a summation there. That means I am summing over, because I is look like a free index, okay. So it is a free index, but there are twice I is happening. So we are not using a summation convention here. So what about summation PI? What will you get? Suppose I sum over full set. What I am going to get? This will be identity, right? Because if I take any vector, and suppose three dimension, you find the component along this, projection vector along this, projection vector along this, projection vector along this. If you add all of them, you get the same vector. So this will be identity. So this is the basically the completeness relation you know about an orthonormal basis set. So here I is same. So I and j are same, obviously. So because there is no summation here, so this is equal to same thing, and you get phi I itself. So that is why pi square is equal to pi. Fine. So next is, what is pi pj when I and j are different, they are not same? What will be this equal to? Pi pj, this will be, yeah,
zero,
because if I take a component along this direction, after that if I can find a component along this, that will be nothing. So this will be zero.
So can we see that it is delta ij pi?
If for, so I said that if for I is not equal to j, if I is equal to j, if suppose for any I and j, it is basically delta ij. Okay. Into, so because when I is equal to j, what are you supposed to get? You are supposed to get pi. Okay. If I is not equal to j, you get zero. So there is, again, there is no summation convention. Please understand that. So now I am just writing P, not using that I, because that will confuse regarding the summation convention. So P square or P into P equal to P. These are all projection operators. So that means P into 1 minus P equal to 0. So now a simple question, what will be the eigenvalues and eigenvalues of this operators P? What will be the eigenvalue of this operator P? We have P into 1 minus P equal to 0. Okay. So you just think about it. Okay. See whether you can come up with an answer. Question is, so this is, P is basically a projection operator. And the question is, what are the eigenvalues of this projection operator? Okay. Whether I can, without writing the matrix form and all, from this, can I understand about that eigenvalues? Okay. So, that's a question. So we will come back to the matrix again when we in detail discuss about the operator, because we have to discuss about the Hermitian operator or Hermitian matrix and unitary operator. Okay, and so on. So we will come back after we discuss in detail about the linear operators. So any questions? So this is the part I am going to ask you till to, for the examination. So any question on this? So there are, you can actually consider some sequence, x1, x2, x3, etc. Yeah?
So, what is the difference between projection operator and unitary operator?
What is the difference between projection operator and unitary operator? Okay. So, see, projection operator. So, okay. So, unitary operator is a general class of operators, or unitary matrix is a general type of matrices. Okay. Like a symmetric matrix or Hermitian matrix, okay, whatever, there are different types of matrices. One type is the unitary matrix. So if I can give you some question, okay, suppose, what is the definition of a unitary matrix? U dagger is equal to U dagger U equal to identity.
So this is the definition of a unitary operator or unitary matrix, does not matter. In the case of matrix, it is a complex conjugate transpose. But in the case of an operator, you have to find out the conjugate of an operator. So that I have to discuss later. So I have to find out the conjugate of an operator. If I have some operator, I have to find out the complex conjugate of an operator. So this is the definition of a unitary matrix. Let us talk in terms of the matrix. Now, any matrix if I give you, for example, I give you a question A, B, C, D. This can be a question in the examination, okay? So I give you a matrix general A, B, C, D. So what is the condition that this matrix is a unitary operator, unitary matrix? So you have to, you can find some condition on that. So can you give me an example of a unitary matrix? Somebody can suggest me one example for a unitary matrix. Yes?
An entity matrix of R are unitary, identity matrix.
Identity matrix, obviously, because I dagger will be equal to I dagger I is equal. That is a very obvious example. Okay. So trivial example. Identity matrix is a unitary matrix. Also, another trivial thing, not that trivial, you can accuse, you know that orthogonal matrices, right? So what is an orthogonal matrix? O transpose equal to O transpose O equal to identity. Right? So do you have an, so what is the difference between transpose and dagger?
It's a conjugate.
So you have to take a complex conjugate of that. So this is a more general case. This is a one special case when matrix is a real number, right? So matrix is a real matrix where there is no complex entities. But you already know some examples for orthogonal matrices. Can you give, now you remember what is this cos theta, sin theta, minus sin theta, cos theta, right? So this is, oh, great. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So this is cos theta, sin theta, minus sin theta, cos theta. So is this a orthogonal matrix? Yes or no?
Yes,
it is an orthogonal matrix. So is this a unitary matrix?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. So now you want to introduce some complex number here. You can now you know, because that into that conjugate will not change. Okay. So that you can introduce some complex nature into that. How will you introduce some complex nature into that? So that u dagger is equal to I. So you can think about that. So this is an example of a unitary matrix. Okay. So there is, in general, I should be able to write, suppose this is alpha and beta, gamma and delta. If I take where alpha, beta, gamma, delta are in general complex numbers, so there you can actually find out a relation between alpha and delta and beta and gamma, such a way that general 2 by 2, I am talking about 2 by 2 in this case, 2 by 2 matrix is a unitary matrix. So that is a, so any example I can give you and say that whether it is a unitary matrix or not. Now your question, whether the P operator, is it a, which is a projection operator, is that a unitary operator? That is your question, right? So you have to see whether P, P dagger is equal to P. So if it is a what? If it is unitary operator, it should be equal to, or unitary matrix, it should be equal to I, right? So this is the condition. P P dagger should be equal to P dagger P. It should be equal to I, right? So this you have. So now let us look at, for example, you take the P, okay, which is equal to, for example, phi 1
bra phi 1. What is P dagger? What is P dagger?
Bra phi 1, ket phi 1.
No, it will be again ket phi 1, bra phi 1. Okay, it will be same. P dagger will be also an operator. What you said is bra phi 1, ket phi 1. This is a number. This is in whatever we said that this is an orthonormal set, this should be equal to 1, a number. But P, so I had to teach you how to find out the dagger in terms of the operator that I will come. But now you take it from me. So because what you should do is this one dagger you have to do. So complex conjugate transpose you have to do. So you know that bra phi 1 will go to ket phi 1, okay, and ket phi 1 will go to pra phi 1, okay. So that is what happens. So basically you know that, let us just think about AB transpose, okay, just want to, as a matrices, AB transpose, what is that equal to? B transpose, A transpose, okay. So this will shine light, some light on this, how you have written this, but later on when we discuss about the linear operator, how to find out the conjugate operators, we will clearly discuss, but this conjugate is this one, okay. No, the complex conjugate transpose is this one. So what is P P dagger? So that we have to find out whether that is an identity or not. Is it an identity operator? Whether P P dagger is an identity operator?
Sir, it's P itself.
Yes, sir.
P. It is P. It is not identity. P P dagger is P, because P dagger is equal to P dagger equal to P, right? That is what you got from here. P dagger is equal to P. So P P dagger is again P. But what we require, PP dagger is an identity. Okay. So in terms of vector, if you want to look at that, if I have a vector V, okay, so vector V, I took a projection along this one. Okay. Then if I do once more, you get this one. Okay. So if you are saying that this is an identity, what does that mean? Suppose PP dagger is equal to identity, what does that mean? If I act that P twice on this, I will get this itself. Do you get that? You will not get that, you will get this. Okay. So PP dagger is not equal to identity operator. PP dagger is P. So this is not a, P is not a unitary operator or unitary matrix. Okay. So the P is a one special case. So you can actually write down P operators matrix form. Okay. So let us write down that. Because I
on the projection once more.
Pardon me?
Can you explain why it is not the identity of it? I mean can you explain it?
Huh.
I mean here that is not identity.
Okay, so you see, we already said that P dagger equal to P. That understood, right?
Yes,
sir. P dagger is equal to P. So P P dagger is, we want to, so we can clearly say that P P dagger is cannot be identity without doing a calculation. Why? I have a vector. Okay. So this is P P dagger is nothing but, because P dagger is equal to P, this is nothing but P P. Okay, because P dagger is equal to P. So I have taken a vector. First I projected along. So P is a projection along some unit vector, right? So I projected along this x cap vector. Okay. So I get this one. Right? Now I do again once more, I will get that only. Okay. So P square, I will get this one. But if you are saying that this is an identity operator, what does it mean? If I take a vector,
If I do twice P, I should get this itself. That is what identity means, because P, P acting on V, okay, will give you some vector along phi 1, if it is P is phi 1, some constant. Okay, if it is an identity, what should I get? PPV is equal to V itself. That is not at all possible. Okay, well, so what?
If
yeah?
V is only along.
V is? Yeah.
V is only along phi 1, only one component.
Okay, I understood what you are saying. Suppose my V is along this one. Okay, so then obviously PP is identity. See, that also again along this means it should be exactly the X cap itself. If it is 2 X cap or 3 X cap, you will get a different magnitude. Okay, PP, V will give you some other magnitude. Okay, so but that is not the case, because we are talking about the operator, not for a particular example. Okay, you should, so PP acting on any vector is giving you identity then only. So when I say U dagger equal to I, okay, so matrix case no problem, you have a one example of matrix. But if I take an operator and say that U dagger equal to I, that means if you take any vector in the its domain, so in the there is a linear vector space, there are so many vectors in that, so one operator will have its domain and range. Okay, so if one operator has to be a unitary operator, okay, for any action on, so any U dagger action on any vector in this domain should give you an identity. So this, you cannot take a one specific example and say that okay, it has given me identity, it is an identity unitary operator. It has to act on each and every vector in its domain. So I will talk about domain and range a little later. Okay, so any other question? Should I continue with the next topic or should I stop? It is up to you.
Sir, please continue.
Okay, fine. So now let us discuss about, one second. So we started saying that there is a series or a sequence x1, x2, x3, etc., say xn. It can be even infinite series, but it's a discrete numbers, okay? So this sequence can actually, it can be one, this can actually represent a vector in a vector space, okay? So there, this kind of sequences form a vector space. For example, even if you look at the three-dimensional Euclidean space, the or example two-dimensional space, each vector you denote with the two numbers, 1, 2, like that, right? So you denote with some numbers. These actually are the components of that vector along some arbitrary direction, means along some basis vector. So this is a one vector in a vector space. Basically, this is a sequence of numbers. So when will you say that vector space, okay, whatever vector space you are talking about, okay, is a square summable vector space? Or when will you say that this sequence is a square summable sequence? So this sequence is a square summable when mod xn square for each n is less than infinity. So there is a sequence, so you wanted to put n, okay, so let us put I. So if this quantity is less than infinity, then we say that it is a square summable, okay. So L2, small L2, say L2 space. So this vector space is actually an L2 space, where the sequences in that vector space actually satisfies this criteria. So now you can actually generalize this to capital L2. So what is that? square integrable. So then you have the functions. Obviously, this is a discrete case. So now I go to a continuous case. So you have to do the integration. So this is a function. So when will I say that this function f of x, a square integrable function, or this function belongs to L2, when the quantity, in general, you can have a domain, okay? So AB, so in this range AB, okay? So L2, AB, so basically the function is defined in A to B, okay? The range A to B. So I can put A to B. Then the integral f of x. So these functions and this sequence are in general complex. So do not confuse that that is a real quantity. That is why I am putting mod, okay? So less than infinity. So if the function integral, whatever the range you are talking about, this mod f of x square dx, when you do this integral, if that is less than infinity, you say that that function belongs to a square integrable space. So why it is having a lot of importance? Because our quantum mechanical, so somebody said that is a light quantum mechanics, right? So our quantum mechanical wave functions should be square integrable wave functions. Why? Any idea? Because whatever the quantity you are looking at in quantum mechanics should be a finite number. So we don't want to deal with the infinities, right? So this criteria is there. Your wave function should be a square integrable wave function. So what is the relation between f of x and some abstract vector f? So you don't know what is f now, okay? So you only know f of x. So now can I connect this f of x with some abstract vector f? So, or a ket vector f. For that you have to introduce some basis x. So this is a continuous basis. For in quantum mechanics it can be a position basis. That means, what you mean by position basis? It is a eigenstate of the operator, position operator, with eigenvalue x, okay? So it is a infinite dimensional basis and continuous. That means x can take basically all the real numbers, okay? Because in position of a particle, it can take any in one dimension system, one dimensional particle, a particle moving in a one dimension. So its position can be anywhere from minus infinity to infinity. So this x is a continuous, you know that. So there is an operator x cap which is called as position operator. If I act on that x, I'll get x ket x. So it is an eigenvector of this operator with eigenvalue x. This is a number, this is an operator. Obviously, when I give you, so this form a basis. So you know when I have a basis, there should be what are the things I should be giving you. If I have the basis, I should give you the orthogonality relation if it exists, okay? So if the like phi I phi j is equal to delta I j, you know that. But this phi I phi j, whatever you have done so far, they are all discrete, because I j are discrete numbers. Because this is not a continuous thing. So that is the reason this delta ij, it is basically is a Kronecker delta. But this x is a continuous thing. So what is the inner product of x with x prime? So ket x is a one vector for a given x point in the position. Okay. So bra x ket x prime. So this is a Dirac delta function. So, because you are going to the continuous dimension, okay, so ket x is a vector in that, which is an eigenstate of the operator x cap, and it satisfies, because it's a basis and it satisfies this inner product condition. Also, the completeness relation. Obviously, in this case, what is the completeness relation? Phi I, bra phi I, equal to identity operator, right? Summation, I is equal to whatever dimension you are talking about. So here it is, the dimension is infinite and it is continuous. So I cannot use summation, I should use an integration, right, in the full space. So minus infinity to infinity dx ket x bra x equal to identity. So this is the completeness relation for this basis ket x, and this is the orthogonality relation. So if I know these two, now I can take any arbitrary vector f. I can write it as some identity operator acting on f itself. Now I write down this quantity, because that is the identity, minus infinity to infinity dx ket x bra x f. Fine. So I just written this quantity here, that's it. So this is 1 and acting on ket f. Now I call this quantity as f of x. So now you see the connection between a function f of x and the abstract vector f. So what is that? That is f of x is equal to bra x f. It's a very, very crucial thing, okay? Because, so any question? Yeah. So f of x is equal to bra x ket f. So usually when you are when one chemist, okay, one chemistry person taught you something, or in your earlier classes when somebody taught you regarding the quantum mechanical states, you only know the wave function. This is what, right? So say that there is a wave function psi of x or phi of x. So every wave function is having a abstract vector corresponding to that. How do you get such a psi of x? You do the inner product with the x, so you get psi of x. So this is what I am saying. So any system without interacting with other things and all, you can write it in terms of a ket vector. And what is the wave function you have been talking about, psi of x? So any function, I can have an abstract notation, ket f, and I can get f of x like this. Okay, so this is very, very crucial. So if you understand this, actually you understood a lot of quantum mechanics now, okay, because this is one of the main thing when you deal with the vectors and wave functions and ket vectors. Okay, so any function you can actually write it as an abstract vector. You know the relation between them, and we can have this one. Now what else we have to define now? So what is an L2? We did not say what is an L2. So L2, already I said that. What is an L2 space? Yeah.
So that relation we have to write in terms of a basis. That basis should be infinite dimension, right?
Ket x is an infinite dimension, because x is like a, so I told you one example, because see, ket x can, see, this need not be position, okay? It can be momentum or any continuous infinite dimensional basis, okay? So ket x is a continuous infinite dimensional basis. So other way you can see that, see ket f and this one you written down this. So you are expanding this vector in this base ket x with a coefficient f of x. So you can see, you can also say this in a different way. So f of x is a coefficients of this vector f in the position base when you expand that. But obviously you have to, because it's a continuous and infinite dimension, you have to integrate from minus infinity to infinity. If it's a finite dimension and continuous, it will become a to b. And if it is not continuous, what will happen? Because there is no function like that, this f of x will become some numbers, just simple numbers, not as a function. Okay, but it is a now function because every x you have f of x defined. I think I will stop here now because I will start from the L2 is basically if the function is square integrable, that minus infinity to infinity mod of x square is less than infinity. So I will start from that in the next class. Okay, we can find out the inner product. You can actually find out the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality for these functions in this square integrable space or L2 space. So basically quantum mechanics happens in a square integral space. Okay, so I will stop here now. Any questions? Yeah.
My attendance.